From the Library of Congress in Washington, D.C.
Hello, everyone. I'm Betsy Peterson, the director of the American Folklife Center here at the Library of Congress, and I want to welcome you today to another one of our Benjamin A. Botkin lectures, an ongoing series that we have here at the library. The lecture series, the Botkin lecture series, allows us to highlight some of the best scholarship and work going on in folklore, ethnomusicology, oral history, and cultural heritage studies. And it also allows us the opportunity to build our collections. We see this as one strategy for increasing the material in our collections. And as a consequence, I want to ask you to turn off your cell phone right now if you haven't done so. Each lecture is videotaped and will be placed on our website, and so you can revisit it as a webcast. Today I have a very special honor for me, and I have a feeling for several people here, but the honor of introducing the distinguished historian Bill C. Malone. Professor Malone is Professor Emeritus of History at Tulane University and now resides in Madison, Wisconsin, where he's an active member of the city's academic cultural life. Throughout his history, Dr. Malone has specialized in documenting country music and other forms of traditional American music. In particular, he is the author of the legendary 1968 book Country Music USA, which I'm sure many of you have on your bookshelves. I certainly do. And it has the distinction of being the first and still one of the most definitive academic histories of country music. Malone was... sorry about that. Okay, which is where... Okay, sorry about that. Professor Malone was born on a cotton-growing tenant farm near Tyler, Texas, and grew up with surrounded by country and what we call hillbilly music today. As a graduate student at the University of Texas in the 1950s, he became a well-known singer in the Austin area, performing his repertoire of hillbilly songs at such distinguished Austin locations as Threadgill's, which I have been to several times. His 1968 PhD dissertation was eventually published as Country Music USA. In the years since, Professor Malone has published numerous books and received innumerable awards, including a 1984 Guggenheim Fellowship and a 2008 Lifetime Achievement Award from the Society for American Music. In Madison, Malone hosts a popular weekly radio show, Back to the Country, on WORT-FM, and frequently performs with local country and old-time ensembles in the area, often performing with his wife, Bobby Malone, who is also with us here today, and she herself plays a very respectable mandolin and guitar, and we are delighted to have both of them here with us today. Today, Dr. Malone is going to discuss his most recent book, Music from the True Vine, Mike Seeger's Life and Musical Journey, which was recently published by the University of North Carolina Press. This is all the more meaningful for us here at the American Folklife Center because Mike Seeger has been a longtime friend of the Folklife Center here, and we're honored to have some of his valuable fieldwork and research in our archive. So before I turn the microphone over to Dr. Malone, I want to mention that copies of his book will be available for sale after the lecture, so please, after the lecture, go out, buy a book, talk to Dr. Malone, and without further ado, I will have the man himself come up. Professor Malone.
Thank you. Let me see if I can get this audio started. And I'll...
first unto this country a stranger I came. I courted a fair maiden, and she was her name. I courted her for love, and her love I didn't obtain. Do you think I've any reason or right to complain? I rode to see mine Ansie, I rode both day and night. I courted dearest Nancy, my own heart's true delight. I rode to see my Nancy, I rode both day and night, till I spied a fine gray horse, both plump looking and white. The sheriff's men, they'd followed and overtaken me. They carted me away to the penitentiary. They opened up the door and then they...
Well, that's the other Seeger, Mike Seeger, playing an instrument for which he became famous among many instruments that he played. That was the auto harp. And he was singing an old song that he first heard when he was about 5 or 6 years old, sitting on the floor in his father's front room in Silver Spring, Maryland. A song that he heard on the Library of Congress record that his parents permitted him to play on their variable speed recording unit. That was Mike's, that and songs like it were Mike's introduction to the great realm of American country music. Well, I start out my book by asking the question, who is Mike Seeger? So I can start my talk out the same way today. Because that's a question that I received over and over again as I was preparing my manuscript. And that question was invariably followed by another, is he related to Pete? Well, I'm sure I showed my frustration at such questions, but I submit that I'm not the only person who felt the sting of those questions. Mike himself felt it. I think from his very early age, Mike was very conscious of living in a very special and distinguished family. I remember the first time I ever saw him was in Austin, Texas in about 1962 when the New Lost City Ramblers came through for a concert. And at a party after the concert, while Mike was receiving the guest, I remember someone coming up to him and saying, how's old Pete? You could see and feel Mike's discomfort. I'm not suggesting that there was a love-hate relationship there. There wasn't. Mike loved his older half-brother. And in fact, he took up the five-string banjo because of Pete's influence. It helped eventually to direct his career. On the other hand, though, I think that Mike was always conscious of being in the shadow of an iconic half-brother. Certainly by the time Mike went out into music on his own, Pete had become this great legendary presence who swept millions of people to their feet following great noble causes. But Pete was only one part of the problem. I think Mike was conscious in being a member of a super achieving family. You may not know or may not recall that his parents had been very distinguished avant-garde classical musicians and composers long before they discovered the people's music. They moved over to folk music in the 1930s after Charles went to Washington, D.C. to work for the Resettlement Administration and set his team of researchers out to collecting old songs. Those songs, in turn, generally were deposited in a Library of Congress records, and sometimes, as I said, Charles brought those records into the house where Mike could hear them. Mike's mother had been the first woman to receive a Guggenheim Fellowship for composition. So both parents were distinguished scholars. Both had achieved a lot. And by the time Mike was born, both were involved in extremely important projects. Quite often had no time for Mike. I think we can frankly say that Mike not only suffered from the prestige of his family, but also from the neglect that their business sometimes caused. Then there was his sister, Peggy, 1 year younger. Peggy was also distinguished in her own way, at least became so. Let me read what I had to say about Peggy when she was just a child. While Mike was having trouble identifying with the music his parents made and having trouble in absorbing its principles, Peggy was embracing them. Peggy embraced lessons and readily absorbed musical theory. By the age of 6, she was playing both piano and guitar. At 11, she could transcribe musical notation and took great delight in taking such a song as the Irish Washerwoman through the circle of fifths in every key. Peggy funnily appreciates the way her mother, quote, just opened me up as a musician. Well, Mike, I guess one good way to describe Mike would be to say he was a classic underachiever in a family of superachievers. He probably was dyslexic, although that was not explicitly confirmed during his childhood. But he was unfocused. He was resistant to formal education, resistant to all kinds of musical instruction. His mother tried to get him to learn the piano and the musical theory which went with it, but he rejected that. He also rejected clarinet lessons. He went his own way with no knowledge in nor no appreciation of the classical music that his parents loved. But there was always music in the Seeger household. And he embraced that music, made it a part of his consciousness, although at the time, I'm sure he had no idea that he would someday use this music to make a career. I should say before going into the music that the only passion that Mike Seeger had ever had before he was, say, 18 or 19 years old was cycling. He was an expert bicyclist and a unicyclist. There's a picture in my book about him on a unicycle. But there was no reason why anybody at the time could have foreseen the distinguished career that Mike Seeger himself later achieved. As I mentioned at the very beginning of my talk, he was permitted to play the aluminum Library of Congress records that his parents accumulated. They permitted him to sit on the floor, to use the variable speed machine that his mother used for song transcription. He played these songs over and over and over again. And when the cactus needles that were used for the recordings began to wear out, then he would sit down and sharpen them and then go back to the machine. He also listened to the few commercial hillbilly records and blues records that his family possessed. By the way, Charles Seeger would not permit a radio in the household. He looked upon the radio as being a sinister agent of technology. Maybe not realizing that these phonograph records he had were also agents of technology. But Mike always pointed to one record above all, that played an important role in his emerging career and had played a role in his parents' career earlier. This was Doc Boggs recording, I think on the Brunswick label, of the old murder ballad, Pretty Polly. This has a historic place in the Seeger family, in Seeger family history. Because way back in about 1931, when Charles Seeger was just beginning to recognize folk music and to understand that people like Aunt Molly Jackson had some important things to say, Charles began to go down to Greenwich Village and play in the hillbilly band that the artist Thomas Hart Benton had. Benton played the harmonica, and Jackson Pollock was even a member of the band, if you could believe that. So Charles began sitting in with his guitar. And one night, Thomas Hart Benton brought out a hillbilly record. It was a Doc Boggs version of Pretty Polly. And he was amazed that Charles Seeger had not only never heard this record, but knew nothing about hillbilly records. He said, in effect, how can you call yourself a folklorist? How can you call yourself a student of American grassroots music if you don't know about these commercial recordings? Well, years later, of course, Mike heard this recording in his household and lived long enough to find Doc Boggs and take him out on the concert trail. As I'll point out again a little bit later, that was one of the greatest thrills of Mike's life, what he thought one of his proudest accomplishments. There were also the family sing-alongs. On occasion, Charles and Ruth would bring out the little brochures that the Resettlement Administration prepared. They would sing the songs they found on these brochures. But above all, they would sing the songs that Ruth Crawford Seeger was transcribing for John and Alan Lomax. She was busy in about 1940, 39 and 40, helping them prepare their one-volume song collection called Our Singing Country. And Ruth would listen to these songs over and over again with great discipline, trying to notate them accurately. Now, I think this was a major contribution that Ruth made to Mike Seeger. She said, in order to truly understand American folk music, you have to understand the way people perform the song. The song itself is not enough. You have to know the way they bent their notes and the way they move from one note to another. And so she tried as hard as she could to recreate the actual sound in the manuscript she was preparing for the Lomaxes. She also said that we should call this music old-time music, for after all, that is the term that the so-called folk use to describe their music. They don't call it folk music, they call it old-time music. And that's something that Mike took with him into his career and into the New Lost City Ramblers later. Then finally, as an example of an early influence, there was the occasional visit made by his half-brother, Pete, particularly after Pete began his military career. Pete would sometimes come home to Silver Spring to get a home-cooked meal. He would bring his long-necked banjo with him and play for the kids. That was an experience that neither Mike nor Peggy were ever able to forget. For a long time, though, this music to Mike was nothing more than Seeger music. All these songs that he remembered from his early childhood, these were just songs that the family knew and sang. Seeger music, family music. In other words, the sounds and voices heard on these old records were disembodied voices that seemed to have no real meaning as far as a people or a culture were concerned. That all was to change by the time Mac entered his early 20s. He graduated, let's see, it would have been about 1951, I suppose, with no earthly idea about what he wanted to do. He just knew he didn't like school. At his mother's insistence, he enrolled in a couple of colleges in the Washington, D.C. area and dropped out of both. But by the time he dropped out of Georgetown, he was playing the banjo full time. He had discovered his life's love, although he still had no inkling that he could make a living from it, nor pursue a career. He first learned the guitar by taking lessons from the famous Charlie Byrd, the blues musician that his mother had found out about. So he went into, came down into Washington and took a few lessons. But he refused to learn from the notes, refused to learn from the instruction books that were provided. He would do it his own way. Then he took up the banjo. And he began playing the banjo so often, so incessantly, that he said that even at the morning breakfast table, he would sit reading the Washington Post and playing one banjo phrase, one banjo chord over and over until he learned it. And the banjo became his lifelong love. But in short order, he learned the guitar, the banjo, the fiddle, the mandolin, the auto harp, the French harp, the Jew's harp, the panpipes, which are also called quills, and I guess you'd have to throw in the bass. I'm sure anything with strings on it, Mike learned how to play. But it came with great effort. I'm going to read you something that Bob Dylan had to say about Mike Seeger at some point in his career. Yeah, Dylan saw Mike perform at a couple of music parties in New York City, including one at Alan Lomax's apartment. And Dylan claimed to have discerned very early that Mike already possessed the qualities that he himself was struggling to attain. Mike was extraordinary, he wrote, the supreme archetype. He could push a stake through Dracula's black heart. What I had to work at, Mike already had in his genes, in his genetic makeup. Before he was even born, this music had to be in his blood. Nobody could just learn this stuff. Well, I suppose there's some truth to that, but that's mainly hyperbole. Mike, as I said, worked hard and diligently, incessantly, to learn what he achieved. It was not something that came in his genetic makeup. In the early to mid-50s, the music that heretofore had been sort of a fleshless entity which he had absorbed began to take on a flesh and blood form. He began to see the music in its cultural context, and he began to meet the people who were still making this music. That came with his discovery of bluegrass in the early to mid 50s. Luckily, somebody in the family gave Mike a radio. Despite what Charles had felt about the instrument, Mike began to hear local disc jockey shows. In particular, one person over a station in Arlington, Virginia, named Don Owens. Again and again, people who became important in the bluegrass movement point to Don Owens as being the first influence in their lives. Nobody was calling the music bluegrass yet. Bluegrass songs were merely played on hillbilly radio shows along with all the other fare. But nevertheless, people began to see that there was something different, something a bit more exciting perhaps in the music made by Bill Monroe and Lester Flatt and the Stanley Brothers. One day, a young fellow who had gone to school with Peggy, a fellow named Richard Spotswood, came to the Seeger household and he brought some Stanley Brothers recordings. The first time that Mike had ever heard these records. And his response to them was the same as mine and the same that many people have made. It was almost like a religious experience. I'd never heard anything like this before. Above all, Mike became convinced that the music he had loved as a child was still alive, although it had taken on new forms. He felt that bluegrass was a modern updating of the old string band music of the 1920s. But he also began to hear this music in context. He began to hear an occasional concert, and by the mid-50s, he was going down to the country music parks down in Maryland and Pennsylvania, Upper Virginia, and he began to see in person groups like Flatt and Scruggs and the Stanleys. And following almost in the steps of Richard Spotswood was another young man named Pete Kuykendall, who also brought his records along and his insight into the music. This was a heady period in American music. This is when young people everywhere began to discover bluegrass and forms like it. And this is also the period when the Washington, D.C. area began to be the bluegrass capital of the United States. So many bands that made the music and so many people who were ready to listen to it. Then in 1954, Mike had to make a major decision. He made the most explicit political act of his life. And to put this in proper context, I need to say that Mike had already become conscious that the Seegers were not only prestigious, they were also controversial. And during his life, he suffered from what he called Seeger politics. I think a lot of what Mike did in these years was unconscious, but I think he consciously made the decision to avoid, if possible, Seeger radicalism or Seeger politics, because he knew that what that sometimes did to Pete and to his father. Mike himself suffered on occasion when he was asked by the authorities if he was a Seeger and if the Seegers were communists and that sort of thing. Anyway, the political act that Mike made in early 1954 was to declare himself to be a conscientious objector to the Korean War. So he became an orderly in a tuberculosis hospital in Baltimore. He worked there for 2 years, till 1956. It was a turning point in his life. It was in the tuberculosis hospital, he first met a patient named Robert Dickens. And Robert Dickens then informed Mike, he said, "Well, you ought to come home with me because of my whole family picks and sings, including my sister Hazel." So Mike became virtually a member of the Dickens family. I think they became the surrogate family, in fact, that he did not have from his own family. But above all, to me, this is most important. The music he loved now not only had a human face, it was made by people to whom he was close. He began to play music with the Dickens people in apartments and homes. He went out into the honky-tonks of Baltimore. With them, he went down to the country music parks, played with them there, and also listened to the music. In sometime in 1956, Mo Ash, the owner and proprietor of the Folkways label in New York City, wrote to Pete Seeger, and he said, "Pete, I've been hearing a whole lot about this bluegrass banjo style, particularly style played by Earl Scruggs." He said, "I know you have a banjo instruction book, and maybe you can not only put something in your instruction book, but maybe you can make a record for us, make an LP, so we can educate our audience about what the Scruggs style is." And Pete said, "Well, I don't really have enough time, and I don't know as much about it as I should. But my brother Mike, he knows a lot about the Scruggs style." So it's at this point, then, I think Mike began to be aware that it's good to be a Seeger. He might be embarrassed with family, but there's a lot that positive that goes along with it. So Mike set to work recording mostly Baltimore musicians whom he'd got to know or hear about. And in 1956, he produced for the Folkways label American Banjo Scruggs Style. Some people say this is the very first bluegrass album. I wouldn't go quite that far, but it's certainly an explication of the bluegrass banjo style. Then Mike, on his own, decided to do another LP for Folkways. This he conceived. He prepared, he wrote the liner notes for it. It was called Mountain Music Bluegrass Style. and to my way of thinking, this was the first true bluegrass album. The first album to have in its title the word bluegrass. The first one to try to make any kind of link between the bluegrass style and mountain culture. The first to have liner notes. That was almost unheard of in country music at the time, but Folkways was already doing it. And so the little history that Mike wrote for this album, even today, stands up as a pretty good a summary of what bluegrass music was all about. These two albums introduced, or did a lot to introduce bluegrass music to the folk music revival and to the northern public. The young musicians who were already congregating in Washington Square in New York City now had something they could listen to. And little by little, the Scruggs style began to make its way into the music that they made. Mike got in touch with Alan Lomax, who was a friend of the family. And he, after Alan came back to the United States from Europe, after his self-imposed exile in the early 50s, Mike told him, you know, Alan was looking for modern examples of folk music, some evidence that the folk style was enduring and that it was taking new forms. And Mike encouraged him to go listen to bluegrass. And so the result was that, among other things, Alan Lomax prepared an article for Esquire magazine called, I forget the specific title, but Folk Music with Overdrive. That's the kind of respectability that the music needed. Mike later said, in trying to explain what he was doing during these years, he said, well, I had this mission. And it was a mission, I think, that he had absorbed, in a certain respect, from his parents, along with that zeal to collect and the zeal to make his material known to the public. He loved bluegrass. He could play it. But he wasn't totally satisfied with it. He felt that bluegrass was too limited. I've heard him say this, he felt that too often the bluegrass musician just played the same sequence over and over again. It became too automatic in their style. He loved the spontaneity of old-time music. So while documenting bluegrass music and making its existence known, he was still proud of and still determined to play the music that he had been first introduced to when he was a child. And that opportunity became realizable in 1958 when he joined with two of his friends, two alumni of the Washington Square scene, John Cohen and Tom Paley. Together they organized a trio called the New Lost City Ramblers. They made their first of many LPs for the Folkways Company and then set out on the tours of the northern United States, playing almost exclusively in the North. That was the greatest frustration for Mike Seeger, the fact that while this music was popular, where you could easily find a group to listen to it, almost always the people who listened were in the North. See, this is Southern music, but Southerners will not listen to it. But let's remember that this was during the Civil Rights period, when it was pretty difficult for Northern missionaries to go into the South, even if it was with the South's own music. Anyway, there was nobody like the New Lost City Ramblers in the American folk music revival. I bet I get a handle most from you. How many remember the New Lost City Ramblers? I believe it's unanimous, isn't it, just about? So I'm preaching to the choir here, I suppose, but you may have not have thought exactly what made this group so distinct, so unique. Before the New Lost City Ramblers came along, the emphasis in American folk music performance and scholarship tended to be on the song. The song, other than the style, or the person who made the song, There were some exceptions to this. Of course, Woody Guthrie, Aunt Molly, and Leadbelly had come into New York in the 1940s, made people aware of their music. But generally, the people who paid attention to what they call folk music emphasized the song. Mike and the New Dolls City Rounders were determined to make the American people aware, if they could, of the people who had made this music in the first place. And they set out, as carefully as they could execute it, to perform the music the way it had been originally performed. Their emphasis was upon authenticity, the recreation of the string band styles of the 1920s and 1930s. In doing this, I think they made people increasingly aware of the importance of the old 78 RPM commercial recordings. They were saying, if not explicitly, they were saying that the 78 RPM commercial record is just as important as a document as any other form of folk music artifact. Commercial, yes, but it's an item that moved among the American people and represented the musical choices that they made. And when they gave their, when they recorded their songs, when they compiled their famous songbook, the New Lost City Ramblers songbook, and when they went out on stage, the Ramblers were always sure to tell people where they got their material. To them, it was dishonest to say that this music was anonymous or that it had arisen magically from some mass source. They would say, here's a song which we learned from Tom Ashley, or here's a song we learned from the Carter family. Here's one we learned from Uncle Dave Macon. I think this was a profoundly democratic statement. They were saying that these people mattered. And if they matter, then not only absorb their song, but absorb the way they perform their songs. There's something important in that culture. What the New Lost City Ramblers did inevitably spilled over into scholarship, although it worked both ways. There were already a group of scholars who were beginning to study hillbilly music and beginning to emphasize the old records, but now they could point to the New Lost City Ramblers as being preservers of this tradition. There were a group of scholars in the United States who became known as the hillbilly folklorist, people like D.K. Wilgus, Archie Green, John Greenway, Ed Kahn. Who have I left out? That's the nucleus of the group. And thank God for them, because they were coming along just as I was beginning my own scholarship and trying to make people aware of the validity of the kind of research I was doing and the kind of sources that I was using. Like the inevitable next step then, once you have resurrected the old songs, performed them in the original styles, and made people aware of where they were first performed, the next step is see if you can find those people. Are they still living? And to their great delight, they found out that many of them were. They found, Ralph Rensselaer found Tom Ashley down in North Carolina. I think it may have been Dick Spotswood who found Mississippi John Hurt. But Sleepy John Estes, of course, maybe El Carter wasn't hard to find. She was already on the Grand Ole Opry. But yes, quite a few of the people who had made records back in the 1920s and 30s were still alive, and most important of all, they were still capable of performing. So the Ramblers hoped that once people found out that these people were alive, they could still make music, let's put them back on records, let's bring them out into the concert trail, and let's see if we can persuade the commercial record companies to bring that music out again. And little by little, Columbia and Victor, Decca, began to bring out the recordings of Uncle Dave Macon and people like that. Before I leave the New Lost City Ramblers behind, though, let me play one more recording. I think we need to hear a little bit of how they sounded, although I'm sure most of you can remember. Chose that because that's another example of a song that Mike learned when he was just a little boy in his parents' home in Silver Spring. Another song collected by one of Charles Seeger's teams and deposited in a Library of Congress recording. It was called Colored Aristocracy. And as far as I can determine, nobody had ever recorded that song until the New Lost City Ramblers did. It sounds like it was probably a cakewalk from the 1890s that somehow made its way out into the hinterlands and into the repertoires of hillbilly musicians. And that had been recorded in West Virginia, if I remember correctly, by a local string band. And that was Mike playing the fiddle. That's also different. Nobody else in the folk music revival played the fiddle. And he brought this quintessential hillbilly instrument into this this music. Well, let's conclude by just talking about Mike himself. He gave hundreds of concerts with the New Lost City Ramblers and with others. But from the very beginning, Mike had embarked on his own solo career. And in fact, that sometimes became a problem with the Ramblers. They felt that he shouldn't be out doing his own thing. He had a particular problem with John Cohen. Mike was the supreme multitasker. I started out describing him as an underachiever, but by the time the early 60s arrived, he was a super overachiever, so much so that it took a toll on his health, on his marriages. I think it was probably tough to be the wife of Mike Seeger. It was tough to be one of his children because he was so single-focused on what he loved and what he wanted to make known. He continued to be a master musician, but almost seamlessly, the entertainment which he projected as a musician became also an example of education. Mike's concerts became learning devices. When you heard Mike Seeger, you learned about the song, you learned about the way the banjo was played on that particular cut, you learned where it came from, because he could play just about every style that the instrument was capable of doing. But he continued to be a collector, a documenter, producer of LPs. He was so involved simultaneously with so many things that it was difficult for a biographer to do his story adequately. At least I had the problem. How do you really describe Mike Seeger while he's making all these concerts? He's also out in the field collecting the music of all these old timers, and he's producing their LPs, and he's giving lecture concerts. He's doing residences in colleges. Right toward the end of his life, just a very few years before he's died, excuse me, Bobby and I visited with Mike and Alexia, his wife, in Lexington, Virginia. And we're out walking with him, and I think it was Bobby who asked the question. He said, "Mike, of all the things you've done, how do you assess your role in the American folk music history? What are you most proud of?" And this is what he singled out. He said he was most proud of having taken Elizabeth Libba Cotton out onto the concert trail and Doc Boggs. I think significant because both of these people had very central, important roles in his family and in his growing up. I guess everybody's heard the story of Libby Cotton. Libby worked for the family as a housekeeper. One day, I believe it was Peggy, went into the kitchen and found Libby playing the family guitar, the Seeger guitar, playing it upside down. They said they didn't even know she could play a guitar until they just accidentally came upon her. So little by little, Mike began to record her songs and eventually produced an LP on the Folkways label. Peggy took one of these songs, among others, to England. It was a song called Freight Train. Freight Train became a hit in England and then was brought back to the United States. And it took a devil of a long time and a lot of money, a lot of effort to ever get Libby any money from this song. But Mike said over and over again, he was proud that this brown-skinned woman who had helped to raise him, who had cooked him cookies, would finally live long enough to go out and perform in public for the American people. The other person, Doc Boggs, I've already referred to. Doc had played a central role in his family's discovery of folk music. He was central to Mike's growing up in the late 30s. And Mike was delighted to find out during one of his concert trips that Doc Boggs was still alive, living in Norton, Virginia. So he visited Doc Boggs and found out that shortly before Mike arrived, Doc had brought his banjo out of hock and was ready to play it again. So Mike almost immediately found Doc a festival to play on and then often travel with him over the years. And Doc Boggs said again and again he was proud of the role that Mike Seeger had played in saving his life and giving him a new audience. I think Hazel Dickens may have made the best statement about Mike, though, that sums up his relationship with other old-time musicians. She said, "Mike validated my culture. He was the first outsider to recognize and understand the music that I did, and he made it possible for me to make a life from my music." And I think that was true of a lot of the old-timers who found that new leases on life and new audiences in which to perform their music. How do you compare Mike Seeger then to his brother Pete? Well, there's no way that I could ever denigrate Pete Seeger, and I wouldn't attempt to. But I will say that I think that Mike Seeger could do things on the string instruments that Pete could never do. Mike Seeger was a better musician than Pete. But beyond that, I think Pete took the music and instead of using it for his own purposes, either for propaganda or for political objectives, he took the music for its own self. He put himself in the shadows and put the music up front and reminded us of the humanity of the people who had made the music in the first place. To me, what Mike Seeger did was as important as what Pete Seeger did in his own way. Matt brought humanity to folk music scholarship, and he made us aware of the wealth of material that lay in our past. And he made it possible, among others, for people like Alan Jabor, to discover that it's not just the old-timers, the commercial old-timers that are important. There's a lot of people out there still making music that we've never heard of, like Tommy Jarrell and Henry Reed. And I think one thing that Mike was proud of by the time he died is that there was a resurrection of interest in the South. Southerners were, little by little, were beginning to recognize their own cultural contributions. Of course, we had to mention Doc Watson. Mike didn't discover Doc, but he came around the same period. And I guess, finally, I would say that I personally owe Mike a great debt of tribute. I say in the book that when Mike Seeger came along, I was impressed by what he did. But I wasn't quite sure of his objectives. I wasn't sure who this guy Mike Seeger was. I felt this is some kind of Yankee interloper who's interfering with my music, the music I grew up with. He'll probably play it a while and go on to something else. Of course, that idea came totally from ignorance, from not really knowing who Mike Seeger was or where he came from. So it was pretty common for me and my friends at the University of Texas who sang old-time music to sort of make fun of Mike Seeger and the New Lost City Ramblers, his Yankee boys who were trying to sound like hillbillies and not quite achieving what they tried to do. But I must confess that while making sport of them, I was buying every record they made. I bought their songbook. I went to their concerts. I memorized their songs. And when it came time for me to do research on the manuscript that became Country Music USA, I found their research invaluable. I found the names of people that I had never known. I grew up with people like Uncle Dave Macon and the Carter family. But because of Mike and the New Lost City Ramblers, I became aware of people like Charlie Poole and people like him. So, Mike, if you're listening anywhere, thanks. You made my career possible. Okay. All right. Do we have any questions?
Okay. I just want to make a brief comment on New Lost City Ramblers in the South. I was in Atlanta in the 1960s. And I played a lot of music there and was interested in this kind of music. And I remember seeing the New Lost City Ramblers playing, I think the place was called the Bottom of the Barrel. And not quite, and it really was the Bottom of the Barrel.
Well, I'm sure they felt that way a lot when they played in some of these clubs.
Yes, I think so. So there was something of an audience for them. The main reason I remember that old-time music was not popular in the South during that period was that, at least in the urban areas, white Southerners were embarrassed by it.
Mm-hmm.
Natives of the region, you know, they were onto rock and roll.
Yeah,
you know, popular music.
Yeah, I think that's true. Younger Southerners had gone on to some of the commercial offshoots of old-time music. They'd gone into blues or rock and roll or Elvis.
Example, right. Yeah, that's true.
I think you're right that it took a while for people to overcome. It took a while for the country music industry, so-called, to overcome its sense of inferiority.
Yeah.
Before they set up their own Hall of Fame and began collecting data from the old-timers, both in and outside of Nashville. Yeah.
Well, I was wondering, with any kind of personal relationship between, he was an odd character between him and Mike Seeger?
No, but there was a relationship between John Cohen and Harry Smith. I think John took some photographs of him, and he did a lengthy essay, at least one or more, on Harry Smith. But you're certainly right about him. One of the reasons why it was possible for a group like the New Lost City Ramblers to exist is because, well, first of all, the Lomaxes in the 1940s had put out a few of the old commercial songs. They brought, did a couple of albums, I think for Brunswick and for, no, for Victor and for Decca. And then in 1952, this very eccentric collector, Harry Smith, took his collection to Moash at Folkways and persuaded him to put out a box collection. So people began to become aware of this music that had been recorded commercially between, say, 1923 and 1938 or so. I think that was his purview. Excuse me. And I remember the impact that the collection had on me. I was browsing through the public library in Austin, Texas, and there I found that big box, black boxed collection called American Folk Music. And I opened it up, and I found some familiar names like the Carter Family and Uncle Dave Macon. And I was thrilled. The music I grew up with, the music I love, is being brought back again. And it's, now it's been called folk music. I always thought it was hillbilly. And here it is being produced by this, what I thought was this prestigious company in New York City, of all places. But I later found out that other people were having similar reactions. Everybody from Bob Dylan to Joan Baez, and of course, John Cohen and Mike Seeger and Tom Paley. And so, in other words, people in the folk music community, they knew that about the old records, but they didn't really know that it could still be produced until the New Lost City Ramblers began touring and performing the songs in their own way. And then, of course, from there on, it was from that time on, then people began looking for the originals and hoping that the record companies would bring them out again. Okay.
I thought Color of Aristocracy was a really good example to play because I had added to your list of Mike's contributions, helping to bring in a whole instrumental phase of the folk music revival movement, because the old revival was really song focused, and Pete, in effect, perfectly illustrates that. Whereas Mike was he loves to sing, but he was an instrumental guy.
Right.
He played, his shows were like a choreographed presentation of the instruments you can play, and
mm-hmm.
all lined up on
yeah.
stage, and
he'd
go grab one and turn around.
Yeah. And on his album covers, he would stand in front of an array of instruments, too.
And I think you're right that having a fiddle tune, Colored Aristocracy, on that early record sort of typified, sort of opening up a whole new realm of possibilities there. And the once the instrumental revival got going, which he certainly had a hand in getting going. It also opened up the connection to dance, you know. And
he began to do that toward the end
yeah,
of his career, too.
He got very interested in mm-hmm. dance himself. It was a very important sort of shift over to instrumental music from, not that people abandoned singing,
mm-hmm.
but that they added instrumental music as a focus.
That's a great point.
Question I wish I had asked. To what degree and in what form was there crossover in the mountains between the black community musicians and the white community musicians? Was there a black equivalent of the old kind of players?
Well, I should have, you know, since it, where's my book? And I call it Music from the True Vine, and yet I made no comment at all about why that was called that. And of course, that's something that Mike, toward the end of his career, began emphasizing over and over again. I guess it had been implicit in his career earlier, but he hadn't made any formal statement. And that's the idea that you're referring to. He felt that Southern music as a whole was a product of the interrelationship, the interaction between black and white Southerners. And they borrowed from each other, not just in the flatlands, but in the mountains as well. People like C.C. Conway in her book, African Banjo Echoes in the Appalachians, you know, it's a good example. She claims that the banjo style wasn't learned exclusively from minstrel performers who toured in the area. It was learned from African-American musicians who moved into the mountains and who worked in various projects or played on street corners. But that's what he meant by music from the true vine. The true vine of American music came from this interrelationship between the music of the black and white Southerners. Okay.
I just want to follow up on what Betsy said earlier, that thank you for a wonderful lecture at the Folk Life Center Reading Room. We really benefit from your work.
Thank you.
Books on the shelf. And I would also say that the archive has about 700 hours of Mike Seeger's recordings. If you want to do research, all of those interviews with Doc Boggs, all those concerts, all those Ramblers recordings are in the archive. And we also have the John Cohen collection. So if you want to explore the relationship between John Cohen and the Ramblers and Harry Smith, you could do it one-stop shopping at the
Okay, great.
And people like Leslie Riddle, who, you know, talking about the interrelation of black and white music, who helped the Carter family learn a lot of their songs, was someone that Mike sought out and documented, and we have those recordings.
Yeah, okay.
I was interested in the point that you made that Mike wanted to promote the older musicians, and yet, as an example, the recording that you played first of When First Unto This Country, in 1978, when the English folk rock band Fairport Convention recorded that, it's the only song on which their fiddler puts down the fiddle and plays the auto harp, which is an obvious
borrowing
to Mike, not to the Gant family, because they didn't have an auto harp on the recording. So what would happen is that the New Lost City Ramblers version would actually become the one that became the most popular. Did that bother Mike if that happened, do you know? Or what was his attitude toward his own fame? I know he was kind of uncomfortable with it, but what more do you know about that?
I think he was uncomfortable in being put forward in front of the group. That happened to him from time to time when the New Lost City Ramblers gave concerts. You know, the placard would say Mike Seeger and the New Lost City Ramblers, and that bothered him. And they say, you know, that at parties, in jam sessions which he played, he was always just part of the mix. He never really put himself forward in any dramatic way. He was very happy to listen to other people play. He was always learning. And I remember referring to him, I would say, Mike, when you mastered such and such, that would make him uncomfortable. He said, I've never mastered anything. He was always a student.
Pretty complete background to some of the tunes, but I'm from Texas and I'm very interested in the western boundary, you might say, of the folk revival. You know, there are a lot of, you talk about southern music, it's really southeastern music to a large degree, and I'm really fascinated by the western boundary of the folk revival, if you want to phrase it that way.
Well, one thing that always bothered me about the New Lost City Rambler presentations, and you could find this a little bit in Mike's early work too, was this emphasis on the southern mountains. They always tried to make it appear that everything they got came directly from the mountains, either from commercial companies that went there and recorded people or from Library of Congress expeditions or whatever. And then a lot of the examples they would give were people like Uncle Dave Macon, who came from Central Tennessee. We got Jimmy Rogers, who comes from Mississippi, and he came from everywhere. And I think that was a lot. Egg Robertson from Texas, Prince Albert Hunt, on and on. And I was troubled with the fact that they wouldn't venture into early Western swing at all. That's a very viable product of the old time string band movement. So there were a lot of areas that they stayed clear of. And I think that was a kind of a holdover from earlier folk folklore scholarship, an emphasis that goes back to Cecil Sharp, if not even earlier. The idea that American folk music comes from deep in the recesses of the Southern Appalachians. Some of it did, but a lot of it didn't. So I think you're correct in saying that the parameters ought to be broadened dramatically. Did I get it sort of at what you were saying?
Yeah, you know, the ground in which the true vine, from which the true vine grew was right. So rich, I guess there's a lot there to mine.
Mm-hmm.
I'm interested in, I don't know, in the Bob Dylan bio thing that they had some years ago, they had, he initially portrayed himself as rough hewn from Gallup, New Mexico. I was amused to see that, but you know,
in the Gant family that somebody mentioned back here, who contributed when first into this country, a stranger I came, that was a Mormon family from Texas. I think they may have migrated from someplace else maybe, but they wound up in the hill country outside of Austin. So American folk songs, American country music came from many, many sources.
One more comment. Okay. Alan's father, John, did some fabulous field recordings in Texas.
Okay. Great.
That's when he was teaching at university.
Okay, one more question, then we're going to have to.
You mentioned that when you were younger, you felt some suspicion toward the New Lost City Ramblers and Mike Seeger for being northern interpreters, essentially. And I wonder, you know, we've talked a lot about what he did for folk music, but I wonder, do you think his relationship with Southerners changed so much with kind of general practitioners? That, I mean, obviously with Doc Boggs and people that he knew closely, but I just wonder.
I don't think that Mike ever had any problem with Southerners at all. He was apolitical in that sense. He was personally liberal, but he wasn't bothered by political questions. And he would have gone into the South. He would have performed more there than he did if it had been possible. Tom Paley was against that.
Yeah.
He was very much opposed going South.
Were buying his records the way I was?
I don't know. I doubt it.
Yeah.
I'm not sure who was buying his records, really.
Yeah.
College students.
I want to thank Professor Malone and for a great talk.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Thank you. This has been a presentation of the Library of Congress. Visit us at loc.gov.